What's up, Collider Video fans? Jedi Council fans out there? I'm David Griffin, one of the co-hosts. You know, Kristian allows me to come on Jedi Council, thankfully one of the best shows on Collider Video. I'm also one of the co-hosts of TV Talk. Yeah! 3 years ago, Jedi Council was formed, you know, to have one of the most passionate, obviously, as we can see here, fan bases, you know, of third-party Star Wars news out there, and it wouldn't be possible without you guys. Of course, you can see everybody lined up here, so I'll just get right to it. Kristian Harloff, your Darth Harloff himself is here, everybody. Kristian Harloff, welcome.
That's pretty awesome. I appreciate that very much. I like that so much, I'm not going to introduce anyone else. No, I'm kidding. So what we're going to do for you guys today, plain and simple, because we got, first of all, got to give it up for the great Dennis Zen himself. Give it up for Dennis. And also, you know, a lot of times you guys don't see, like, what happens, like, behind, whether it's Jedi Council or Schmodown or TV Talk, the guys behind the camera that don't get the love they deserve. I want to hear a big pop for Dad Williams right there. And last but not least, he looks like a DJ tonight. It's Clip Clopping, Clop Clopping Copster. There he is. All right. It's going to be pretty fun. What we're going to do, we're just going to run this like a Jedi Council show. And what we'll do is we'll have movie news. We'll do, what's the deal with Canon? We'll do all of it today. And then instead of the Twitter questions, obviously, what we're going to do is we're going to have you guys do a Q&A, which will be like, that will be our Twitter questions. So when, you know, it's like, okay, it's time for Twitter, just line up, ask your questions. You want us to talk about some stuff? Then let's do it. And if you guys are ready, let's do it! Yeah! All right. I want to bring up first, this guy's been a buddy of mine for a very long time here now. We started in the YouTube space, and I'm so happy when we were able to bring him on to the Collider team. It's John Solo, Jeremy John! Yeah! And before I go on, too, how about one more shout out for D. Griff, David Griffin. Yet another new council member that I've had the pleasure to get to know over the last year. And you talk about someone that just digests Star Wars. She is such a great addition to the council. It's the Grand Moff Nemiroff, Perri Nemiroff. Another guy that I've been friends with through thick and thin. I want to hear you guys go nuts for Kylo Ken. Ken Napzok is here! Kenny! All right, they got two more on the council today. He's my buddy. He's been my partner for a very long time. You saw him walk in. I'm not going to call him Baby Carrots today because he's Mark 2D2. Mark Ellis is here. like Randy Orton. I love it. Last but certainly not least, I pitched this show about 3 years ago to another Star Wars fan who is just as passionate as me, as these guys, as you guys, the one, the only, Obi-John Kenobi, John Campea is here! All right, so let's get down to it, man. We have a little bit extra time here, which is great. And thanks to you guys for coming on out. All right, so here we go. Welcome to another episode of Collider Jedi Council. We are here live at Star Wars Celebration, and what a show it's going to be. We got the full council here, and we're going to go over stuff. First, the way we started out is everything happening in the world of movie news, Star Wars movie news. It could be episode 7, 8, 9, Han Solo, Obi-Wan Kenobi movie. It's coming. I'm telling you. I promise. I know it is. All those movies, we're going to talk about it right now, but the first thing that we're going to talk about here is the recap of the 40-year panel that happened today. Yeah. And it was something special, man. I mean, it was really something special, and I want to start out with Ken Napzok, who was sitting with me, and we were going over this thing, and the first thing that we can talk about here was just that video up front, Ken. Like, take us through it. Like, what were you feeling, and how did you feel watching this panel?
No joke, I started crying 20 seconds in. Can't take it, because when you're surrounded by fans who have grown up feeling and experiencing the same thing as yourself, and you thought you were alone on an island, me in 1983 as a 7-year-old who was bullied for wearing a Return of the Jedi t-shirt, to be surrounded by thousands upon thousands of fans who feel the same thing, within 20 seconds you start crying because you know, as Han Solo said, you're home.
That's right. All right. Now, Perri, you and I didn't really talk about it much, but I know that I felt it. It was like there was like a sea of sniffles, including myself, like during a lot of this stuff. But it even started with that video up top. I mean, because for me, being a dad and seeing like my daughter is 5 and a half, starting to really get into Star Wars and watching it. And there were just videos of like little girls dressed up and little kids just dressed up and watching everything going on. Like, did you feel that right off the bat? Like, oh, that's what we're in for. They're really gonna pull on the heartstrings here.
The good thing about sitting next to this guy during that panel is no one could hear me sniffling, because he
and extra pretzels
so much louder than me. It was incredible, though. That whole thing is just so well done. The way you can celebrate a franchise, and then you could have a great, beautiful tribute to Carrie Fisher that was moving in just the most appropriate way. And then you end with the ultimate surprise, John Williams. It was just the complete package, the perfect way to start off the celebration on the right note.
Absolutely. Now, Jeremy, you know, you and I beforehand, we were talking about, like, what are we going to see? And we're like, well, I thought George Lucas was going to show up. I thought that Han Solo. Well, there you go. I thought Harrison Ford. I can say Han Solo here. Harrison Ford would show up one way or another. I thought maybe it was a video package or he would actually be there. Turns out he was there. How did that feel having him come out? His first celebration, by the way. Did you guys? I didn't know that. I knew that he was at Comic-Con, but I thought that he'd been at Celebration before. Did you know that this was his first?
No, I didn't know this was his first. It was really funny because there's no video. I just did I filmed a video before I came here of me ultimately just kind of gushing about that thing because it was such a special and emotionally impactful moment for me, just in the way it unified fans through all generations. You know, there are prequel haters. There are, people who love the prequels, people who hate the prequels, vice versa. But in that moment, it was like there weren't prequels or original trilogy. There was just Star Wars, and everyone was there in this sandbox safe space of just enjoying it all for that reason. But I took no video of it because I didn't want to. I was like, I just want to look at it happening. And as I'm watching it happening, there was a knot in my throat of tears. I just wanted to break down and cry, but like I couldn't, because then I'd miss like a half an hour of it like that, you know. And so I never got to do that, but it was a really special thing for me. It really was through all. Seeing Mark Hamill, and then when there's that one space left, and I'm like, if Warwick Davis goes, I'm like Harrison Ford's coming. Right. And then the moment he started, I'm like, oh my God. So it was a big deal. It was a very special thing.
John, you know, when Lucas came out, like we had assumed that he was going to come out, but we also didn't know like how he was going to maybe react when he was out there too, because we know that he even said it as much in the panel that there were times that you could tell that he was hurt by like whether it was things that people had said about the prequels. but just certain things that throughout time, you know, he took little shots that he's been scorned, and he knows that sometimes George will take those little shots there. But it was really cool to see him obviously celebrating these 40 years and just watching him to really go through it and being reunited with Warwick Davis. And how cool was that seeing that shot of Warwick when he was like, I guess 11 like 9 years or 10, 11 years old. Yeah. So what were your overall impressions of the way kind of George handled it?
Well, we knew like you can't do Star Wars 40 years and not have the creator there. I mean, that just would have been ridiculous. And you know, regardless of what anybody says about the prequels, we all worship at the altar of George Lucas. Like a lot of people who even are big Star Wars fans don't understand how much George has done for the film industry as a whole. It's not just Star Wars and how many generations of filmmakers he influenced and inspired to become storytellers, but it's also he pushed, like when he sat up on the stage today, you know, I created digital cinema. He wasn't exaggerating. He's the one who single-handedly pushed digital cinema into the real age.
Right.
When you want to talk about things like if you want to talk about sound, if you want to talk what he did to sound, if you want to talk about ILM and what he did with visual effects, I mean, when you go throughout the entire genre of whatever the film industry is, George Lucas's fingerprints are on it. And you can never understand, and it just wouldn't have been the same if he wasn't there.
Mark, you've been known to tell a joke from time to time.
Not so much funny ones.
Well, that's where I was going with that. No,
it's the effort that counts, gentlemen.
No, but Warwick Davis, though, how about Warwick Davis? How great he was, like those little shots. Not only did he take at Anthony Daniels, about telling him his head was too big to get through the door, whatever, the big door, but the shot he took at Harrison Ford about the plane, and then Harrison rolled with it and laughed. Did you appreciate, you know,
Warwick Davis did a monster job hosting this panel today. And I love that Warwick Davis is able to take a shot at so many people, but he also made fun of himself, too, as an 11-year-old kid writing a letter to George Lucas.
Cool was that letter?
That was so awesome. That people used to write letters. Like, they used to actually...
Right.
It wasn't just at George Lucas. Hey, I don't like Jar Jar. Right. Hashtag you suck. It was like a real letter. But kicking off the... I got emotional watching Ken Napzok get emotional, because that guy used to...
I had to hug him three times.
He ran security at a mall for 20 years, and he's getting teary-eyed because Chewbacca's on stage. Like, that does something to me. Yeah. But honestly, we've been to D23s, we've been to Comic-Cons. Yeah. I have never seen that many people that I love on one stage together. And I've seen Lynyrd Skynyrd 38 times in concert.
Right. Well, that's a great point, though, too, because I think that, look, sometimes, and we said it as much on the show last year, I think that if you were at Celebration last year as a fan in London, you probably had an amazing experience walking around, even looking at what they do here. It is, with Lucasfilm, it's all about fan service. It certainly is. But I think that a lot of people that we've talked about on it for certain news and the way that maybe we weren't as satisfied as we wanted to be. Well, I think they kicked everyone in the nuts with this one, because, like, right? I mean,
even the girls got kicked in the nuts!
That's right. That's right, everybody got kicked in the nuts. And because you think about it, it's just like they're saying exactly what Mark just said. Shut up and watch this. Watch George Lucas come out. Watch Mark Hamill come out. Billy Dee Williams come out. You know, all this. I was surprised that Dennis Lawson wasn't there, though, because they said he was going to be there.
Well, they said he'd be here.
I wasn't surprised.
No? Why not?
There's a prickly history. We know that. I wanted to give him a big standing ovation, though. Maybe tomorrow.
What do you think? He's dressed as a Wookiee, not showing anybody his face?
He's dressed as Obi-Wan.
As Obi-Wan. All right.
I think Wedge is doing his own panel called I Survived Too. He's the only other dude to make it through both Death Star assaults. The guy is clutch.
That's true. He is. But I know, I just what's that? Don't worry. Sometimes it happens. If you're a Star Wars, you're a lightsaber! What? Don't worry about it. That's fine. It's an urge. I get it. I understand. But anyway, so this watching this stuff, but I think that the big reveal, and David, I wanted to get your thoughts on this too, is that, I mean, because we, like I said up top, and I was kidding and serious at the same time about Obi-Wan spin-off movies and whether or not they were going to give us anything. And you're wondering as it's going through, and you get the Carrie Fisher tribute. And at that point, I turn to Ken, I go, they're going to end with this, and they should end with this. As you're watching this, and just the emotions that are going through you, but then those curtains open up at the end. And you're like, well, wait a minute, holy kids in the audience. but you see, and it's John Williams. Like, what was going through your head, David?
That was incredible. I mean, I saw John Williams do Star Wars in concert at the Hollywood Bowl a few years ago, so I've seen him before. But one highlight I just wanted to point out, and we got to kind of talk about their highlights. For me, the prequels sometimes, you know, they get a little bit of hate, you know, not, you know, as, you know, well received as the original trilogy. But I love the fact that when Hayden Christensen walked out, Ian McDiarmid walked out, he got a standing ovation. He deserved that standing ovation. So I just want to show some love to Hayden Christensen. I'm just glad that he got a standing ovation. Because, I mean, he's a part of this universe. He's a part of us, right? I mean, he is Anakin Skywalker.
Yeah,
you know, he's a young Darth Vader. But yeah, back to the music, man. John Williams is just incredible. I mean, I've heard him before. It was a surprise. In fact, he did three songs. I thought he was going to do the one, maybe a little something else, and walk off.
Right,
but he came back
and
did the third
play,
one.
And then they would kind of end it that way. But he kept going. And
yeah, it was beautiful.
Right. Yeah.
You know, by the way, Hayden Christensen, just a good Canadian kid. By the way, if you heard one maniac in the panel this morning, every time Hayden mentioned one syllable, going, it was this nut job over here.
Yeah.
The head of Collider.com and Collider Video, his name's Mark Fernandez, and it was like, this guy's psychotic for Hayden Christensen. That was him.
But it was cool. I mean, it was really, I mean, for me, Palpatine's my favorite character in all of Star Wars. And watching them talk and listening to me, hearing that voice, because John at one point goes, oh, he's got to do the voice. I go, he's doing the voice. Listen to him talk. But all of that was so cool. It was really nice to see all of it, and I'm really glad they did it. It was a great way to start celebration.
Yeah, and I don't know that anybody's ever hidden a 35-piece orchestra in a room without anybody knowing.
Right.
Like, was that Abbott or Costello that came up with that idea? Like, right. We're going to hide these people in a room. Who was sitting right next to the curtain? Did you hear like a flutist warming up, or when you're like, what the hell was that, a harp over there?
Right.
Like, how do we not know? What is wrong with us as a society? There is a giant orchestra hiding behind a little flimsy curtain with the greatest conductor that ever lived, and we're all like, oh no, that's storage. That's not. We're good.
All right, so I normally say this on the show. Mark, what's next?
Next up is the huge panel that we all have been vastly anticipating, and some of you guys are about to go camp out for it right now. In news that we first broke on Jedi Council, they're making a sequel to The Force Awakens, everybody.
Yeah.
And it is
breaking news. Breaking news.
The name of the movie is Los Jedi's Ultimos, and... Yeah. Which is the coolest way to say that.
Yeah.
We all have predictions up here on the council, so Darth, I'll throw it back to you first. What do you think we're going to see tomorrow at the Last Jedi they have 90 minutes to
90
impress
minutes.
Us with something and surprise us with something.
I think that it would be, they're not going to do this. It would be a huge mistake if they don't show the trailer. They're going to definitely show the trailer. They have to, because, I mean, if you look at what they did with The Force Awakens, we got The Force Awakens teaser in, like, November, like, the year before. Mm-hmm. And then they gave us, at Celebration 2015, that's when you, again, got that, like, more of a teaser trailer. They have been doing this for exactly what I said before, to where they knew last year didn't deliver maybe the way that they wanted it to, and Rogue One wasn't exactly ready the way that they kind of hoped that it would be at that time. But Last Jedi has been shooting for a long time. Remember, originally it was supposed to shoot in May. Debut in May. But they never changed shoot dates.
Yeah.
So they're ready. They're ready to go. They're going to show it. You think it's going to go crazy in that room? But there's news is so much more than that. Perry, like, do you think? I think Benicio del Toro is going to be there. You think so?
Ooh. I would be very happy if he did show up. I mean, at this point, I'll take just about anything I can get from The Last Jedi, because last year with the Rogue One panel, it did feel like we knew a lot more going into it. So even though I was thrilled to see whatever they would show me and see anybody on stage, I feel like I was already a little ahead of the game, whereas it's like wide open right now with what they could do tomorrow. I do think we're going to get that trailer that is a teaser trailer that feels like a full trailer.
Maybe like 2.5 minutes? 2 minutes?
I feel more like 2 minutes probably, but it's not so much about time as it is about just, you know, giving us those quick shots of, like, sure, the cast of players you're going to see without revealing too much story, so that leaves the door open for another trailer down the line. But really, at this point, I will take anything I can get at that panel and be absolutely thrilled about it.
What do you think, you big grouch?
Thank you. I'll tell you who's going to be here, and I'll tell you a story to get to the point and take some notes here. We all flew up from LAX, a lot of fans were there. We love it when you come up and say hello. And a lot of the fans at the LAX terminal we were at kept brushing by this very nice man in a beard and a suit jacket to, like, hey, Jedi Council. The man they were brushing past was named Rian Johnson, the director of Star Wars Episode 8. So he'll be there tomorrow. Pay attention to what he looks like, because he's a very nice guy.
Yeah. All right, so Jeremy, what do you think? What are we getting tomorrow? Besides, I mean, we know, we'll talk about the trailer a little bit more in depth in a second, but what do you think? Because we said an hour and a half, so what are we going to get in that hour and a half?
I love that we're going to talk about the trailer a little more in depth in a second. What I liked about it was that part that I don't know because I haven't seen it.
Well, I don't mean breaking it down. As far as, like, you know, what we hope or we're going to see and those kind of things.
Yeah, an hour and a half is a pretty, that's a tall drink of water, sure, to fill up. Today they filled it up with, I mean, seeing how an hour and a half goes by in a segment like that,
there were
a lot of segments to show. So that is, like, what are they going to show? I want to salivate. I want, by the end of the Last Jedi panel, I want to think I'm not getting the trailer. I want them to show a video of, like, ooh, some behind the scenes, and here's some droids, here's some monsters,
right,
and then maybe, oh, there's a gun, and right, it's a planet. It's gonna be so good. You guys are gonna really like it. Oh, here's a character. Rey has a new haircut. Rey's new haircut's amazing. And then we're all like, All right, and a little bit of, you know, talking, and Ray's going to be like, I got a new haircut. and we're not going to know, and then right before it's like, hour and a half is coming up, and they're like, boom, here's a 2-minute and 30-second trailer, and then I just get my mind blown, and then I run back to the hotel to get on my little camera, like, God, is that a trailer? Yeah. And then I just, that'll be off.
True. I think, and John, I think that's probably pretty accurate. I think similar to what they did in 2015, I think we'll get... Yeah. Kathleen Kennedy coming out, introducing Rian Johnson. They talk about some stuff. They'll show some still shots, and you kind of start to break down and bring out cast. Daisy Ridley will come out. The place will go crazy, exactly. And, you know, Boyega will come out, Oscar Isaac. And they'll start to get the cast that was there, and then they'll start to bring out some of the newer cast, I think. But the trailer, I think the trailer comes right towards the end, like Jeremy's saying, but I think they show it twice. I think that they always do.
For Daisy Ridley, John Boyega, Oscar Isaac, all Canadians, by the way. So, here, look, just hang in with me for a second, okay? Just for a second, all right? They're done shooting this movie. It was supposed to release in May. They've booked an hour and a half for this thing tomorrow. All I'm just saying, if they pull a D23... where you so get to the panel bears? Tomorrow and they start making you check your cell phones at the door, they're showing the whole movie.
No,
I'm telling you, if you get to the panel tomorrow and they check phones, because they didn't check phones today, if they check phones...
It's going to be an hour and a half movie?
I'm telling you, it's a lie. It's deception. No, what they put in the trailer, and they're definitely going to show the trailer, what they put in the trailer, I honestly, at this point, I beautifully don't care. Because whatever it's going to be amazing, and we're going to lose our minds over it, and I'm just so psyched to see it. It's our first real look, and whether or not they're going to show Luke speaking or not, if he does, whatever. I mean, you know what's going to happen if they show Luke and he turns on a lightsaber and goes nuts on some fools. I mean, there you go. I mean, I'm going to lose all control of my bowel movements. I'm going to just have an absolute
blast. He just did, actually.
Yeah, it's going to be nuts.
I mean, if you think they're going to show the whole movie tomorrow, I'd like to remind you that Jim Beam and Jack Daniels, two good Canadian kids. I think that if the panel's 90 minutes, by my math, that means they could show a trailer 45 times. And that's what I want, because, look, I've been the jackass in a room before, and I might attempt to do it here again. I don't want to know too much about this movie, all right? I want to hear them talk about how much fun it was to make. I don't mind seeing the stars of the movie, even some new cast members that we haven't gotten before. I want to see the trailer, and I want to get the hell out of there, because the secrecy around this movie seems to be something special. Adam Driver and other cast members have said as much, that if they had their way, you would not see one glimpse of footage until you actually saw the movie. So the marketing campaign for this film is going to be very, very different than we got with The Force Awakens. I like the mystery, I like the secrecy, but I'm with John Campea, where I will lose all control of every bodily function I possess if I see a lightsaber light up in the hands of one Luke Skywalker.
These are grown men. Hold it in your pants. Listen, the other thing Ken just said too, I'm very curious from the audience here too. How many people for tomorrow, let's say tomorrow, we're all assuming we're getting a trailer. Very, like the Beauty and the Beast mob if we don't get it. I'm asking you guys right now. So if we show a trailer, it's a 2-minute trailer, we know we're going to get another one down the line. Round of applause. How many people don't want to hear Luke speak in the trailer tomorrow? All right, I think I know the answer is. How many do want to hear him? Makes sense. Perri, all right, so let's say, what do you think, you know, as far as, are they going to show any story elements? Because traditionally with trailers, they'll show little teasers like they did, again, in 2015, where you see Rey on the speeder and she's going through. Do you think that they're going to show a little bit more story because we're not even, too far away?
No. I have a feeling what we're going to get is what I said before, and it's more so just a montage of all the key characters, maybe a couple of lines of dialogue, maybe one from Luke. I have a feeling if he speaks anything and it's just one line, or if he lights that lightsaber, that's where it's going to end. It's going to be this build where look at all this stuff, look at all these people, right. And then it's just going to be boom, and that's it. Cuts to black, and if that's how it ends, I won't... lose all control of bodily functions like that. But I'm going to be very, very happy.
This panel is going to be brought to you by Depends tomorrow.
It's true. D-Griff, before we move on to the next subject, so what do you, I mean, you know, we mentioned potential people coming out, you know, maybe other actors, you know, Benicio del Toro, maybe an Andy Serkis shows up. I don't know. I mean, there
could be... Laura Dern.
Laura Dern. I think Laura Dern will definitely be there. That's a good call. But I also think, I think very similar, and I think this should be... It should be a theme for the entire week. Is I think we're going to get another homage to Carrie Fisher, and I think we should. I think because from the rumors that have been circulating is that in episode 8, she's going to have way more of an arc than we saw, and it was leading up to that. Obviously, the things that she had to deal with in episode 7, and spoilers if you haven't seen The Force Awakens. everyone's like, if you haven't seen it, you should probably leave the arena. But you know, let's see. So, David, do you think, they're going to do a little bit more of the homage to Carrie Fisher and anyone else that you'd want to see?
I have a theory. Today for the 40th anniversary celebration, we had videos from some of the actors who couldn't make it, right? You had Liam Neeson, you had Samuel Jackson, they're on set doing their other projects. But we didn't see Ewan McGregor. And he's big enough that I feel like he could, you know, just like Samuel Jackson, put his little cell phone there and done a little 30-second video, and he didn't do one. I think at the end of this, the Last Jedi panel, I think they're going to bring Ewan McGregor out, you're going to have Kathleen Kennedy, and they're going to sit down and talk about the next Obi-Wan film, which is going to be the next standalone movie.
I love that prediction. You know, I love that prediction. I just think it's tough. I think that they want to end the convention with everyone talking.
Come on, Kristian, give me something.
I think that happens at this convention.
Do you?
I don't think it happens at the Last Jedi.
I don't see
panel.
Let's get right into this, Mark. Yeah. What's next? This goes into it.
Okay. Go ahead.
I'll throw to you first.
I'd like to make one bold prediction before we move on to the next subject, if I may.
That you're gonna lose all bodily functions.
The Last Jedi will make $200 million. No.
I'm not betting you on that one. I'm not gonna bet you on that one. No, I'm good. I'll bet you 215.
My serious prediction is I think that you're gonna see an old favorite, which is why I think Ewan McGregor might even walk on stage tomorrow because he might be in the movie. I think that Luke is the Last Jedi. He was referred to as the Last Jedi. The first person that said that was Yoda when he said, "When gone am I, the last of the Jedi will you be." Now, Yoda, syntax was not his strong suit, but I think that you could see a Force ghost of Yoda, and you might even have Yoda be the one that narrates the trailer tomorrow. That's my bold prediction.
I love that prediction, too. I love that prediction. All right, well, Mark, let's move on to the next one, because that's exactly what we're talking about here. What's next?
Well, you figure we got all this gang up here, we might as well start speculating and predicting and prognosticating about other Star Wars movies that may happen in the universe sooner rather than later. Kristian George... What's our next Star Wars movie going to be?
Well, I think that the conversation should go into if we're going to, what John just said, do we think we're going to get announcements about standalone movies this weekend? I don't think so. I don't think so, and I don't think after what we just had today and what we're going to get tomorrow and then Rebels fans are going to get the next day, I don't think that we're owed anything to get that news now. I still think D23 is going to have some of the news. I think that everyone will be satisfied with that is here. I think that everyone will be satisfied that is watching. And I think that if they were going to do it, they would have done it at the 40 year. But Jeremy, you were going to say...
It has nothing to do with an Obi-Wan movie, but I was going to say that this is probably because I like messing with people, but I would, what if they just bring Ewan McGregor on the panel and just don't say why he's at the Last Jedi panel?
He's here to hang out with Dennis Lawson.
That's totally what I would do.
And is he going to pull like a Jimmy Kimmel and say, "We ran out of time for Ewan McGregor, we'll get back to him next time"?
I have to. I absolutely would do that. Actually, if they do that, that would just be more intriguing. I'd talk about it more, like, what does it mean? Yeah. But I think it's possible that he could be a Force ghost in The Last Jedi. And I believe it was, I had a fan in Brazil, because The Last Jedi could be singular or plural for us, but when it came out in the Brazilian market, they were like, I got so many tweets like, Jedi is a different word for singular and plural here, and it's plural. So there's more than one that they're talking about in the movie. So I find that all interesting. I would be down for an Obi-Wan movie, though.
Yeah, I mean, again, Ken, do you think we're going to get any of that news that they're going to do standalone? Am I wrong?
I have it on good authority that Bright Tree Village, The Life and Times of Chief Chirpa, is in development. I know it's happening. They've locked up Low Gray, Wicket, a little difficult. Paplu is a drunk now. Won't even appear in the movie. I'm with you. I don't think we need it yet. I'd love to. I've been wanting an Obi-Wan in the desert movie for a long time. Yeah. Rebels proved that there is a thirst and a hunger for it. Our friend of the show, Steven Stanton, did an amazing job.
Yeah, he did.
Doing old Obi-Wan, yeah. Old Ben, actually, I should say.
So good.
I want it, but I don't think we're going to get it.
No, so John, so you know, you still think you're pretty sure they're going to announce it? If so, because if you don't think they're going to do it at the Last Jedi panel, when would they do it?
No, that's a great question. The timing of it is when would they do it? I don't think the Last Jedi. I think one of the things they showed with today's 40th, because I think I kind of thought that maybe they do it at the 40th anniversary panel. I was so glad when they did. Like when I saw what they were actually doing.
Right.
I mean that panel was just perfection. That kind of leads me to think that maybe they're really going to keep the Last Jedi panel about the Last Jedi,
right.
and that's great too. So, I mean, I don't know. I mean, it's certainly possible they don't announce it, and that would be cool too. I'm going to go on a limb and say I think they're going to do
it
though. Probably on maybe even on Sunday.
See, you know, closing ceremony is interesting, but I think that normally the last 2 years what they've done is this future filmmaker panel. And 2 years ago at Anaheim, they had Gareth Edwards kind of show that little teaser, Rogue One thing, talk about it. We started buzzing about Rogue One right away. Last year, they didn't really do much at all. And I think that it was smarter for them to say, well, we don't have anything really prepared right now. So let's not announce that we're going to do that. And I think that because D23 is in July, it's a week before Comic-Con, I really think that's where we're going to get the title of Han Solo. I think that's where we're going to start to see the first images from that movie. And I just believe that's when it's going to happen.
Yeah, I mean, I think if there's something that Disney has learned from the last couple of Star Wars celebrations, it's that you don't necessarily rush into giving the fans news because
right.
there's been directors that were attached to things and then dropped out. Or there's been films that have been shot, then they wanted to go back and do some reshoots and tinker around with it. So I don't think they need to give us too much meat because we have The Last Jedi. Now, having said that, that puts a lot of pressure on The Last Jedi's shoulders to give us something tomorrow, which is why I think it's going to be like the greatest panel
right.
of all time. But if I had to have a movie that was announced tomorrow or on Sunday or whenever, I think I'd be cool with an Obi-Wan standalone movie.
Just not trilogy, right?
I don't need a trilogy.
I'm with you, mowing his sand
in the desert for, you know. But I would like to see an Obi-Wan trilogy that feels like a Western, kind of like Logan. I think that'd be sweet.
All right, well, now we're getting to that point of the show that we simply call
What's the Deal with Canon?
That was good. That was really good. How about that?
Everything in the world of Star Wars that isn't necessarily the movies, but it'd be TV shows, comic books, novels, whatever it is, video games, we're going to talk about it. Mark, let's start with that one. What's up first?
All right, Kristian. Well, we have the Rebels panel that is going to be on Saturday. The Rebels panel is 90 minutes from 11 to 12:30, so get your sleeping bags out now. And it's also going to be followed by a Rebels press conference that is scheduled from 12:30 to 1. So, Kristian, what are we going to see?
I think this will be like they've done every year. I mean, Rebels has been consistent as crushing celebration every year for the last year, the year beforehand, they announced, I mean, they were the talk of the town last year with Thrawn. And I think, you know, in the year before that, they showed the trailer with Vader. They're going to do something again. And I do, and I've been saying it on the show, and I'll say it again. I think that it's the last season, and I kind of think that it should be the last season. And I'll tell you, I know everybody loves it. I love it too. But I'll tell you, I just think for where we are arcing wise, we're close to, I mean, it's about when season three was a year before the events of Rogue One and episode four. So what are they going to do? Like, and now we're 5 months before, and then the next season will be 3 weeks. So it's like I think they could end it now. Dave Filoni could have all these plans. He'd be watching them. Shut up, morons! I got plans. Don't worry about it. But David, what do you think we're going to see tomorrow? Are we going to see the season four premiere? Are we going to see the trailer? And do you think this is the last season?
I think it's going to be the last season. Also, think we're going to get two episodes.
You get
a full hour. I know Perri was in London last year, and she got to see a full hour of Rebels. I think we get the full premiere. Also, I think we're also going to get the announcement of the next animated series that we know they're working on, too.
Yeah.
Can I do one more thing? Just throw it out there?
Sure.
I know this is probably not going to happen, but...
They're going to announce an Obi-Wan movie?
No. All right. So, you know, Marvel, who's also a part of Disney, as many of you know, is doing a Spider-Man film with Miles Morales in it. Right? Yeah, thank you. But it's doing animated form. I think they might do another animated feature, maybe with Ahsoka.
I like that. Yeah, I like that play. Ken, let's talk Rebels, man. So what do you think? What's going to happen tomorrow? What are they going to show?
I think they're going to show how they're going to wrap this series up in a very good way. I'm happy with the idea of there just being four. I don't want this story to linger. I don't want it to be like the seventh season of Gilmore Girls, where you're like, just wrap it up.
I love that that's your reference.
It is my reference now.
I know.
Lorelai and Rory had very tough lives set last year.
Right.
And I think so. I Thrawn's still alive. Callus, what happens to him?
Yeah.
You know, does Vader come back? Where are we at? Do we get a shot of Ahsoka Tano? Do we get to see that kind of stuff? I think it's going to be something that gives us a clue to how this is going to wrap up and maybe where it ends up. Are we going to see the Battle of Scarif from the ghost point of view? All that kind of stuff.
John?
I mean, I do believe it's the last season. And if it is the last season, they've got a lot of ground to cover. Because I have a feeling, we talked about this a couple years ago, I have the same feeling I think most of us do about Rebels that we had about Rogue One going in. It's like, nobody's coming out of this okay. I mean, there are bad things laying ahead for this group of people, and to see where they're going to be heading is fascinating. You know, one of the things they've done best with this show is their characters. They've done such a great job with making us care about the characters. And I think that's going to be the strength of the final season, because we're going to see the resolution of, like, what's going to happen to Kanan? I mean, who cares what happens to Freddy Prinze Geller? But, I mean, what's going to happen? What's going to happen to Kanan?
He's not even competing tomorrow.
We already saw Dave Filoni cut that dead weight Sam Witwer out of the show by killing off Maul. But what really interests me isn't even so much the panel. That's gonna be great. What's really interesting me is the press conference.
Yeah.
Like, what are they announcing at the press conference?
That's a great question to throw to Perri. What's that?
New show,
you think? You think probably?
But they already kind of put out the press release.
Well, that's something else. But that's them. We're gonna talk about that. Those are like little shorts. But I think a new show is certainly possible. But Perri, two questions for you. The first one is, what do you think is gonna happen? Why are they holding this press conference? They do it every year. I mean, they absolutely do. Probably everything that the press is gonna see and questions they're gonna ask. But is there gonna be like a big reveal, you think?
Yeah, I think there is gonna be a big reveal.
Special guest, maybe.
It goes back to your other question on what's gonna be the next movie. I don't think they're gonna announce a next movie here. If they announce another standalone, I think it's going to happen at D23. The new project I think they're going to announce here is the new TV show, whether it be a new animated show or maybe even a new live action show. And if it happens, it'll happen at that Rebels panel, because The Last Jedi, like I said before, it's all new. That whole panel is going to be news no matter what they show or tell us. Rebels, however, could pave the way to a perfect time to announce a new type of TV show. Yeah. But last year, they did do the same exact thing where they had the panel and then they had a press conference after. So I don't think the press conference is what signifies anything. They're just going to use that time for press to have a little quiet time with all the panelists to kind of reiterate and ask some deeper questions.
I think I got a little bit, I'm going to go the other way just a smidge, just because of what happened in the panel between Pablo Hidalgo and Filoni today, that we can just mix the two of them. It seemed like they were teasing that they were going to show some information. They teased a little bit, because you're talking about, like, everyone's going to die. One person, if you watch that panel today, that we know doesn't die is Rex, because they've confirmed it today. Rex is the old man from Return of the Jedi. I love it. And they had teased that before. Phony had teased it before, but they showed concept art of him in there in the place when crazy. Jeremy, you know, and I ran into you and I told you about it. Do you like that reveal that they kind of retconned that in there?
I love that reveal because, I mean, there's one thing that these series have done, like I was talking about the divide between the prequels and the original trilogy fans, is that the Clone Wars saga and Rebels kind of just smoothed it over and was like, hey, there are elements here that you're going to like, that you're going to see in the original trilogy. And that's part of it. That's part of it right there.
Sure.
As for what we're going to see, as someone who likes binging the Blu-rays. I haven't seen the season of Rebels, but I'm a big Thrawn fan, so I'm looking forward to binging this season of Rebels. They could show a trailer. It'd be a shame if this is the last season coming up and they don't do something big, because it's the last time you're going to have a Rebels reveal at Star Wars Celebration. And if it's time for it to go, it's time for it to go. Like, the worst thing is when a show doesn't know when to die. Like, out there, there are two kinds of people. People who say Dexter was the best show of all time because they watched up to season 4.
Right.
That's and people point. Who wish that Rebels knows when to die because they watched through season 8 of Dexter. Right. So, you know, it's the worst thing ever when a show doesn't know when to go. One thing I do know, after tomorrow, there are going to be 3 new Snoke theories, so that'll be fun.
That's absolutely true. Now, David, you know, going into that panel that we saw today with Filoni and Hidalgo also, I mean, I think that one of the things that both of those guys so well is, and they've said as much in the panel, was taking characters that they created, that we've fallen in love with, that other people have created, and putting them in the right way, in whether it's rebels like Thrawn, or, you know, talking like, and they brought up Cad Bane. And Cad Bane, for what they, that, listen, that if you guys haven't watched the video, and I think that if some people don't know, that I think, I don't know if this is true, if anybody watched the live stream, when you were watching that panel, apparently they didn't show the artwork. Did it? And it's not just pumping my own thing, but I actually taped the whole thing. So if you actually want to see the artwork, I do have it on my Facebook thing. So I have the entire artwork there. So, and it's awesome. The artwork itself was like, it was great, and we got to see, and I actually taped the whole thing. Take us through, David, the Cad Bane versus Boba Fett. And are we going to see, you think, like, are we going to see more Cad Bane? Because Filoni was like, I'm not saying anything. That makes me believe we're going to see him in the trailer tomorrow, or Saturday, excuse me.
Well, it's interesting, like, it's so... The animation wasn't finished, but the vocals were all there. And it starts off with Boba Fett coming to the situation where there's a hostage situation. And he's playing the hero. He's like talking to Cad Bane about, look, no more victims, you know, this needs to stop. And he's got this old, like, old school, like, OK Corral, Wild Wild West thing, the draw, the hand slowly going towards the holster where the gun is, and who's going to draw first. And it was so cool. I mean, it was just so well done, so tense. It was cool to see Boba Fett as more of a hero instead of like a rogue who's just kind of out for, you know, whatever he wants. So I love that aspect of it. And in the end, what happens is they both draw and they shoot and they both fall down. Now, we don't really see what happens to Cad Bane, but we do see what happens to Boba Fett, and his helmet's rolling, and you see where that dent, you know, in his helmet came from. And that was Lucas. Lucas actually told Filoni to put that in there.
Boba Fett shot first.
Yeah, yes, that's a new shirt. New shirt idea. So
that was like the most perfect time to like heckle I've ever heard in my life. It was like, did you guys practice that before? that was expert level.
Of course, Filoni ended it after that. You know, people wanted to know about Ahsoka. They wanted to know about what happened to Boba Fett. And he's like, not at this panel.
Right.
So again, of course, that opens the floodgates to rumors of, are we going to get that bounty hunter film?
I do. You know, I think Ahsoka's going to come back in this trailer. I think that you're going to get, I think Cad Bane is going to come back. But the other question I was thinking, because I wanted to ask a question there too, and I want to see, and I'll ask this at the press conference when we go. One of the things I thought that they, not necessarily, maybe not dropped, because I don't know where they're planning to take it, but it seemed as if Ezra, they were really doing a pitch in the beginning of the season, like, he's going dark side. And then he had Maul. And if you didn't, I put earmuffs here for Rebels if you didn't watch it this season. What's spoilers? Yeah, I got to do spoilers. Yeah, put the spoilers up, Cody.
it doesn't really work.
Cody's
like
not here.
That.
Okay, fine. But the thing,
are you sure?
Ezra, I think so. He's going. He has Maul, who's kind of taking him down this dark side path. And now that that is not the case anymore, it just came to kind of be dropped. But I mean, I think the fact that he still has this dark side thing in him, there's still this anger in him.
Yeah, I think Ezra is like.
It's like, what's happening over there? I didn't really ruin it that much. I didn't really ruin it. I don't think I did. And if I did, Cody, put the music on. All right.
I'm good.
Yeah. Jar Jar is Snoke.
All right, I think the point is,
so.
Anytime somebody like a Dave Filoni is on stage and they say, well, we can't tell you that, it's definitely going to happen. Like, hey, did three Ewoks get drunk, put on a trench coat, and make out with Chewbacca? Oh, well, we don't know. That means they definitely hooked up with the Wookiee.
All right, what's next?
Next up is that Lucasfilm had another great announcement today. They announced the animated shorts starring the women of Star Wars, all of the powerful women that are... in existence in the Star Wars universe, past, present, and future. They're going to make a series of animated shorts around some of them. Ken, what do you think?
I think this is great. It is both of its time and long overdue. And, I mean, look at the names. Rey, Jyn Erso, Ahsoka Tano, Maz Kanata, Sabine Wren, Princess Leia Organa. These are going to be the focus of these shorts. They're going to be about 3 minutes on the YouTube, Disney's YouTube in July, but then they're going to be put together with 8 other stories for a special in the fall on Disney Channel. So they released that video, had some of the mock-ups and the voices. Daisy Ridley is back to voice Rey. Felicity Jones, Jyn Erso, Lupita Nyong'o, Maz Kanata, and I'm sure Ashley Eckstein and everyone else will be back to do their voices. It's really exciting.
Perri, you must have the biggest smile on your face. I know that because when we were talking about it, to me, again, and bringing it up, as having a 5.5-year-old daughter, to see these characters now, like, because we had Princess Leia for a very long time, and even in that tribute video that we saw today about the fact that she and Carrie Fisher had said there weren't a lot of strong women at the time in the movies, and then she was the one, and now we're starting to get, you know, the Jyn Ersos and the Reys, and now we're doing, and Ahsoka, and so now we're doing this. This is a great step forward.
This is huge, and the coolest thing about this is that it's a completely new format for the Star Wars universe. And the short form is just really interesting. The way that you could use a really short piece instead of a whole long film or a whole long TV series to just really hone in on one character and potentially just one moment in their experience. So this list of women, this is something else. And I was a little late to the Ahsoka party just because, you know, I did not know as much as I know now a year and a half ago. Right. And I caught up on all the Rebels. I read the Ahsoka book. I mean, what an awesome character. And after, you know, the animated movie, which is, it's all right. It's good enough. Right now, I am just a huge Ahsoka fan. That book got me so on with that character, and I'm dying to learn even more than I already know about her. And then the other one is Maz. I mean, we need more Maz. What right. an interesting character with a rich history. She deserves more screen time, whether it's live action or animated.
And Perri brings up the books, and we're going to talk about the books to close out canon here, but to tell them I'll be off in a second. If you guys want to line up, start asking questions, line up now, and then we're going to start talking about the books, and that guy's definitely scary. So before we get to the questions, let's do books. Okay, so I actually went by the Del Rey booth today, and I was talking to those guys, and I think we're getting a Saturday is the panel for the books, and I think that we're going to get some big announcements on books. Now, I don't know what they're going to be. I'm not going to pretend to guess what they are. I mean, if you ask me what I hope we get, I always say I want to see exploration into the Old Republic. I think by seeing more of the Old Republic and learning more about it, and I think eventually we will prep to get a feature film down the line. But David, one of the things that you have actually done, I think Ken has a chapter in, but David's about 7 chapters into Thrawn. No spoilers to anybody, but overall thoughts so far in the first 7 chapters, is Zahn back to form so far?
Well, as the head of Collider Book Talk. no. It's not real. I don't want to get in trouble. I love it. It's so good. So I know with the new canon and everything, it can be a little intimidating if you haven't read any of the new books yet. This is one you can pick up and read fresh. You don't have to worry about knowing anything from a previous story. It takes place before Rebels. So it takes place, it's the rise of Thrawn. It's so good. It's definitely worth getting into. I'm only 100 pages in out of like a 430-page book. But Timothy Zahn is definitely one of the better Star Wars writers out there. It's definitely a must-buy.
Sir, so your question, and tell us where you killed the
Dash
person.
Rendar.
All right, so I've been watching the Council since the very beginning when it was still on AMC, and you guys are absolutely wonderful.
Thank you.
That being said, what's up, Ellis? What's going on, man? You remember me?
Congratulations on your team's move to Las Vegas.
No, we met at a comedy club in Nashville. And turns out people do write letters. They write letters to Kristian Harloff.
I gave it to him.
Did you give it to him?
He did.
So what are we doing with Dash, man? Dash has got to come back. So many people have loved this outfit today. And I understand, like, getting rid of a lot of the old EU. I'm glad that Yukazong Vong got out of here, you know. But that pitiful excuse of the kid squadron in the Outrider, hopefully that's not my rendition, right?
No, I mean, I think if they bring him back, I think that they'll probably do it in video game again. I think that's probably what's good. I don't know if they're going to do it through film or through...
It'd be too hard to do that because, you know, Carrie's gone, everybody else is too old.
They probably switch it up the same way that they switched up, maybe put him in a different time. I mean, because the same way they did with, you know, with Thrawn. I mean, Thrawn, because Thrawn, when Thrawn originally, the novels, it was way after Jedi, and in order to make him work today, they put him... like David was saying, way before. So maybe they can fit it into it. Because they're not going to, that's the thing also they're not going to do. As much as I would love for them to redo, whether it's a Darth Plagueis novel in the way that they set everything, or whether it's Darth Bane in the way that Drew Karpyshyn did those novels, they can't because so much is changing, so much is different. I don't think that by Dash Rendar, by having him do it the same exact way, I don't think we'll lose anything as long as they keep the essence of what the character was.
I agree, Kristian. And with that Han Solo movie coming out, I think Dash Rendar would have a good spot in there, and maybe he can save him or something. Or save Han,
he's
and then Dash
so
dies.
Close to him, though.
Oh, and on, speaking of Han Solo, I was wondering your guys' thoughts on, do you think we're going to get any connections with Maz Kanata or the Hutts in the new Solo movie?
What do you think, John?
Yeah, I think they definitely will. I think, and it's going to be early in the movie, I think she's going to play a role in the film, and it won't be a minor cameo either. I think she's going to play a pretty significant spot.
All right.
Where she meets Dash Rendar.
What do you got?
Okay, so Pablo Hidalgo came out and said that Kylo Ren's helmet was most likely recovered after he dropped it. What do you guys think about the lightsaber? Did he lose it? Was it destroyed? And so when it comes back in The Last Jedi, does he have the same lightsaber, or is it different?
I think that's a great question. Number one, I hope his helmet comes back, because that's a damn cool helmet. As far as the lightsaber, it is kind of, you know, we saw Luke construct his own after he lost his first one. I think Kylo makes something bigger and better, and, you know, maybe it's a different color. That's what I think. Unless, you know, you would think it's keep it red, but I don't know. Maybe he goes yellow and we get something new we haven't expected yet. But I think Kylo has something new.
Do they keep a crossguard, do you think?
I thought it looked cool, so yeah.
I think that they will keep it. I think that's becoming, it's already, it became iconic before the movie even came out. I think they're going to keep it. Thanks, man. What's up, man?
Hey, guys. So I have a dirty question.
Oh, wow. Nerdy or dirty? What is it?
Would you rather make out with Jabba or marry Jar Jar?
Jeremy, go for it.
Oh, here we go. I would marry Jar Jar. And I would get Jar Jar back in good with the Gungans, make sure Jar Jar has a really good life insurance policy, and then push Jar Jar down the stairs.
Thanks, man. Awesome, thank you. What's up, man? What's going on?
Hey, guys, how you doing?
Good.
Sort of a real news that Slash Films reporting,
sure,
that the rumor Apple might buy Disney for $200 billion.
What was that? Apple might
Slash Film, it's right there. I promise you, cool computer. Rumored that Apple is looking to buy Disney for over $200 billion.
Wow.
And then Apple changes their name to Skynet.
Very good.
I'll be at the Improv in 45 minutes, ladies and gentlemen.
I mean,
one of the things to keep in mind that the connections between Apple and Disney have a very long history, like even before Steve Jobs.
Yep.
And I believe before Steve Jobs died, I believe Steve Jobs was the single largest shareholder of Disney.
He was part of the founding team.
Yeah, part
Pixar,
of that, right? And I think his estate is now part of that. So, look, we don't know anything about it, but as far as possibilities go, it's absolutely within the realm of possibility when you already understand the existing connections between the two companies.
Well, now they can afford to make movies.
Yeah, valid point.
It would be like really bad product placement. Like, hey, Luke, here's your lightsaber, and this is an iPod. Check it out.
Hi, guys. I got two quick ones for
you.
One, have you guys ever dressed up for a convention, and what was it?
I was Han Solo, and my girlfriend was Kylo Ren. That was before the movie came out, so we didn't really know all the history, but I was Han Solo one year.
I for the release of The Dark Knight, I grew my hair out for a year and dressed like the Joker. Real. Yes. It was like down to here. It was pretty solid. Pretty good stuff.
David, Perry?
I'm struggling enough just to be me, so, you know, I don't know if I can put on somebody else's costume.
Perry?
Does my hat count?
Does your hat count?
No, that's copping out. I've never dressed up for a con, but it will change at some point. Because I look at these incredible costumes, and I'm kind of jealous.
I dressed up at a Halloween party as Dan Cook once.
And my other real quick question, you guys used to do it all the time, but you guys haven't done it lately that I can remember. What are your guys' percentages that Rey and Luke are related? Because it's been a minute.
Rey and Luke. Okay.
Related is a different word than sibling.
Or father, or son.
She's saying Rey and Luke.
Rey and Luke. Related,
or
obviously.
Or father, daughter, whatever.
So it's Rey and Luke, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Rey and Luke. I mean, related is a much bigger percentage than, say, father and daughter. Because I think father and daughter at this point, I'm willing to say zero.
Yeah.
Related, I'm going to go 5%. 5% that they're related.
What do you think?
60%.
Yeah. It's so funny because I was the one when this first came out, I was like at 100%.
that they're related, and I'm so on the other side of it now.
You're not alone.
Yeah, I totally flipped. I'm closer to John. I as low as 3% at this point. I don't think it's possible. I don't think they want to go that route. I don't know. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if they
would were clone count as related.
I don't know. They don't do the
I don't think they're doing the clone thing. I'm just wondering.
Jerry.
What do you think?
You know, if the percentage is dropping for me, I was thinking it was the obvious answer was the answer for a long time, but I still think Obi-Wan and Satine sitting in a tree, K-I-S-S-I-N-G.
I would love that.
I still think it's tied to Kenobi.
Yeah, I think so too. Perri? Percentage?
I agree. 15%.
15%. All right. Jeremy.
There was a big part of me that wanted to work out something like, well, if Anakin was a virgin in the Force and Rey's a virgin in the Force, right. Technically Anakin, Luke, he's related to a virgin in the Force, which means they're related with the Force somehow.
Sweaty.
She's probably a Kenobi, though, so I'll say, yeah, 25.
25. David?
$1, Bob.
Perfect.
All right. Thanks a lot, man. Appreciate it. What's going on?
Hey, guys. How's it going? If they were to do a new animated series and say it would take place after episode 6, what would you guys like to see them do?
Yeah, just so happens this guy, Mark Hamill, is one of the best voice actors of all time. So, you know, to do a live action film with Mark Hamill might be impossible between that time, but why not an animated series of Luke Skywalker, Lor San Tekka, going around the galaxy, collecting Jedi relics, looking for Jedi temples, yep. and explaining a little bit about that.
I think that's great. I mean, there's so much exploration with the Jedi and as far as what he was doing with the relics. I mean, even if you read Shattered Empire, you know, right afterwards, too, and like the stuff that he was doing, that Luke was doing, and not even just, look, if you fast forward even 6 years before The Force Awakens, and when you look at Claudia Gray's novel Bloodline, like right before, like the politics and things that were happening there, there's so much of it in there. Now, whether or not it's focusing on Luke or whether or not it's focusing on the side of what's happening now as the New Republic is building.
See, I think they should do that with Leia to keep her going. You know?
I think so, too. Yeah. I think there's a lot that they can do. I think it's a great question. Thank you.
Thank you.
Right. What's up, man?
So I just first want to say thank you for what you guys do.
Thank you
for just watching. Thank you. I don't have as big a circle of friends that can talk crazy about Star Wars or movies in general, and my parents, I kind of drive them crazy, so so I just say it means a lot to have you guys here, especially being a Florida local, so thank you for what you do.
Thanks, man.
My question, calling back to the Filoni panel, they made a huge deal about talking about the ghost, and they made, I don't know if it was on purpose or if they were trying to hint at it, but they made a point to talk all about what the ghost was doing and hinting at this Battle of Scarif. So my question is, do you think that we are going to end Rebels with Scarif, or are they going to try and do that as the mid-season finale?
What do you think, John?
That's a terrific theory. I mean, I haven't really considered. I always just assumed that Rebels would probably end. I mean, I think in the final season, I think we're going to get a lot of Forrest Whitaker. I think I think they're going to tie it in that way. And I always just assumed they probably end it like 2 or 3 months before Scarif, but that's. I hadn't considered it. That's a really strong possibility.
Because they made a huge point to.
Well, yeah,
show
I mean, we see Chopper, and we hear them. We see the ghost, and we hear them call out Captain Syndulla, or was it General at that point? It was General at that point. General Syndulla, and now I actually thought it was her dad. I thought it was her dad for a minute, but then no, they clarified that no, that it was her. So
I just heard the comment section come to life.
I want the Battle of Scarif one more time because I want Admiral Raddus to say again from another point of view, let's start probing that shield. That's what I want to hear.
That's good. Okay, thanks a lot, man. We're going to be able to do, because of time-wise, we're going to do 5 more.
Hey guys, my name's Swara. I'm a huge fan of all of you and the amazing work you guys do at Collider. Kristian Harloff, you're my spirit animal. You're my favorite Jedi.
Thanks,
you're my favorite Star Wars pundit, critic, everything. I love the work you
do, man.
So I've got a particularly, as John Schnepp would say, a sweaty question about exactly about Rey's journey down the line, and presuming she goes on a Jedi / light side path, and you know she builds her own lightsaber. That's like sort of a key thing about becoming a Jedi, what kind and what color lightsaber would you like her to have? For example, I would really love for her to have a double-bladed yellow.
That's pretty cool. I like that a lot. I do think she'll probably go blue. I think it'll probably be blue, but I think that yellow would be awesome. I tell you, man, just even hearing going through that, I think if they're going to, knowing that we hope that they're going to eventually do episode 10, 11, and 12, I would love to end the trilogy with Rey going to the dark side. I know. I get it. I get it. I get it. I get it. It's like, it's mixed. It's mixed. See, it's mixed. It's mixed. Because it's a different type of arc. Because if
his name is Darth Harloff, he's going to say that.
If Kylo Ren does the same arc again, it's like, okay, we saw the Skywalker that did that already. But if she is related to Kenobi, and if she does go down that path, I mean, it would turn everyone on their head, and it would get that kind of emotional reaction that just happened in the crowd 5 seconds.
She is a sweet, delicate flower, and you will leave her alone, damn it.
Yes! Yes, Mark.
Remember,
yes.
Remember though, in Alan Dean Foster's novelization, in his novelization of the movie, of Force Awakens, that was from the script that was originally there, Michael Arndt and J.J. Abrams' script. She hears voices. She hears someone talking in the dark side. It's already in her head. They're going to play on that. I guarantee you. Now, whether or not she turns or not, that's something else. But they're going to play on the dark side temptation. I guarantee you.
You've been booking schmodown matches too much, man.
Thanks, man.
All right. Appreciate thank you so much, Kristian.
Thank you. What's up, man?
Guys, I really, so I really enjoy Collider. Y'all really inspired me. Start my own YouTube channel, hashtag Darth Easy. So anyways, I have a Smo choice for you.
Okay.
So.
So, DJ Cubster.
So my Smo choice is two potential movies. One, a Darth Bane movie. Or Darth Plagueis movie.
Plagueis.
I'm taking to you, Darth Harloff. What would you choose?
I will answer it, I promise, but I want to give someone else the opportunity also. So, Jeremy,
literally blurted out Plagueis in like 0.068 seconds, which is as long as Data thought about joining the Borg Queen.
Plagueis.
It's true.
That's
Plagueis.
I finally caved and started to read Plagueis because I couldn't wait for Thrawn any longer. If they don't do more with Plagueis, they're crazy.
You're asking a standalone movie of the character?
Yes.
Darth Bane. Because of what Perri just said, I think you can fit Plagueis into a Palpatine movie. And that's something, and whether Palpatine gets a movie or a television show, that's where I'd like to see Plagueis pop up.
I want to see Bane. It's fascinating. I mean, anybody read that old trilogy?
Yeah,
the Darth Bane trilogy.
Man, you haven't read
it. Yeah, it's awesome. By Carpentier. Yeah, I mean, he started the whole rule of two with the Sith, so I want to learn more about that.
Shonen of Clone Wars Season 6 finale, Mark Hamill voice.
Yeah, that's great. That's absolutely.
Young or old Palpatine?
Which one?
Young or old Palpatine?
I think that I'd like to explore kind of what James Luceno explored in his novel, like kind of the rise and how Palpatine was seduced and kind of running through the politicians. Because Palpatine wasn't a good dude beforehand. Anyway, in this novel, he had a messed up, privileged background that Plagueis preyed upon. And I wonder if they would do the same thing. Cool. Thanks, man.
Hey guys, I've been watching since day one. Love you all, and it's surreal to see you guys in real life. Like, I've never done something like this before. It's my first con. John, you said before that you have a film critic that you love, but you guys are like 50-50 on how you guys view things. And I just feel that way about every single one of you guys. I love watching you guys. I get all my news from you guys. It's amazing. I just have one question. Can I take a picture with you guys?
Absolutely. We're gonna be taking pictures after. Why don't you can wait. We're gonna do like three or four more questions. You can wait right over here, man. You'll be the first one. Yeah, you can wait right when you're done. You can wait right over here. You'll be the first one to get a picture. But before we do that, I gotta let Andy Signore take a question.
How's it going, guys?
nice shirt.
I was about to say, man, sexiest shirt I've seen all con. Sexiest shirt.
Beautiful.
I got a quick question, but a very deep question.
Do it.
when Kylo Ren is doing his little seance with the Vader helmet, and he says, show me again the power of the darkness, like, again? Like, is there going to be, like, a evil Force ghost? Is that a possibility? What do you guys think about that?
Oh, absolutely. I think whenever Kylo turned or Ben turned to Kylo and we learn about that, I think that kid was hearing voices from a long time ago, and maybe that's what he was referring to. Or I always think it's his perception of what he thinks Vader is. He overlooks the convenient fact that Anakin, you know, found redemption at the end. I think
so. Do you
absolutely
think he found like a holocron or something? Or is he just...
That word holocron, which when I grew up in the 80s wasn't really a thing, now is a thing that is constantly talked about. Sith temples, some of the stuff we've seen even in the Darth Maul comic, where Palpatine takes him to the temple that you also see in Rebels, which is a great sequence in the comic book. I think Kylo's hearing something.
Yeah, now don't discount this. We just saw in Rebels that Ezra heard voices that he believed was one set of voices to take him to a certain planet when really it was Darth Maul influencing the whole time. Don't discount that Snoke has been influencing Ben for a long time, making him believe it was his grandfather's. I'm not saying that's what I think it's going to be, but certainly don't discount possible. That at all.
Yeah. It might also be Melisandre. Is that the wrong show? Wrong show.
All right. Thanks,
man.
All right, let's try to get, I want to get everybody's, let's go.
Big fan, guys.
Hey, man.
All right, my thing is for John. John's great at the over-unders. So, John, can you give the whole council an over-under on if Luke survives the trilogy? And my question to you is, do you think, with the unfortunate passing of Carrie Fisher, do you think that affected their decision to kill him off at all?
Great.
I will over-under that he survives the entire trilogy. One of the themes of the ongoing themes of Star Wars is the passing on of things and the new generations move things on. I think the over-under of Luke lasting to the end is going to be... Sorry, Mark, it's going to be 12%.
Ooh!
About him surviving?
That's a 12%. 12% that he survives.
Over-under, you're going to go over.
100%! He's surviving!
Over-under.
Right, he's going over the 12. I think that what you said about the Carrie Fisher thing might fit into it. I'm going to go over.
Sorry, Mark. I'm taking the under.
Wow.
Oh, Perri.
Perri.
The second happier question threw me. I'm going over.
Yeah. Jeremy.
So over under what?
12%.
12% and over means he lives?
Over means he lives. For the
well, everybody lives on in the Force, so yeah, 100%. There's your comment section, Harloff,
that's
right
the
there.
Section.
That's your comment right. section. Yeah. No, I think he's
going to... punch the screen now,
you got to move
dude.
It on, Jeremy. We're almost out of time.
I think it's over 12% that he becomes more powerful than you could possibly imagine.
That's right. All right, and with David Griffin?
I'm picking under, but... Because, like, you know, Yoda got... He got three movies, right? He went out in Return of the Jedi. I think Luke's going to do the same, but he's going to go out fighting.
All right.
He's not going to go out.
Thanks, guys.
All right, two
okay, let's move this really quick.
All right, so real quick, I've been the guy from Costa Rica that's been hitting you guys up for interviews. I made it. That's pretty cool.
Cool.
That being said, I'm also one of the admins. The four of us are here of your guys' fan group. We just hit 14,000. So that's pretty cool. That's pretty cool.
Very
so
cool.
My guys are up here. You guys stand up real quick. Stand up, come on.
So do that. That's the Jedi Council fan group.
So this is four of the nine admins we
Facebook,
have of your guys'
join the Jedi Council group,
fan
man.
Group, Jedi Council, yeah. Clearly. Awesome. Anyway, that being said, thanks if you guys are the members of the group, too. Thanks for you guys. Vader's solo movie, what's up with that? We have not been talking about that. It's Vader.
I'll go through this really quick. I love the idea of a Vader movie, and not Anakin, nothing against Hayden Christensen, but I think that we still haven't got all the way through about the purge, about the fact to see him hunting down and learning, and again, going to the novelization of Paul Kemp of Lords of the Sith, and looking just the dilemma that he was going through of, am I Anakin? Am I Darth Vader? Like, it's really compelling and showing what you can do at the end. And I can't stand the argument, we already had that in the first three movies. No, we didn't. We haven't ever
had that.
I
don't sound like that.
I'd love to see it. I just don't think it's going to happen.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
All right, last question.
Hey, one from a girl. So have you ever considered the fact that the ghost could actually survive A New Hope? We have a whole bunch of rebels who are all scrambled and out and trying to figure out where to go next. And we could actually have adventures from them going forward, not necessarily from the Jedi, but everybody else could be there.
What do you think, Perri?
I still think that what we were talking about before could happen, where Rebels ends with Scarif. That's kind of what I do want to happen, because I loved Rogue One so much. And if they're going to drop those little Easter eggs in there, I feel like it's for a reason. It's hard to imagine the Ghost surviving, though, because there's so many things that it would affect going forward, and there's so many different, like, what exactly would they be doing? I can't think of anything that they could be doing that doesn't involve what goes down in the next movies that would get me on board, but you know, there's super creative people behind that show. If they come up with other missions for them to do, or maybe they disperse and we could start doing offshoots, I mean, there's a lot of possibilities.
It could be cool.
I've yet to wrap my head around that, and every single time I picture the scenario where it could end on Scarif, I picture it ending badly, which I don't think that they would do.
Yeah.
All right, so, it was years ago when Dennis Zen over here partnered with me, and we created, you know, what was AMC Movie News is now Collider. And, you know, we had talked about doing a Star Wars show at some point. We talked about doing a comic book show. But it wasn't until Kristian Harloff, you know, came to me with the idea, you know, I really think we should do this show. And, you know, we work on a lot of stuff around there. And for us to sit back here and look out at from that first conversation that we had about let's actually do it, and he became kind of the motor behind making it happen, to now sitting here at Star Wars frickin' Celebration and seeing all you guys here supporting us.
And I wanna grab a picture with all you crazy
maniacs.
Let's get a picture.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.